Do I need to get into it? Do I need to upgrade my facility? Do I need to also, is it going to be viable for an EV dealer in the rural market? Those are things I have to figure out. I mean, I think it might be. I'm not pessimistic about it. I'm just unsure about it. I just have to find a way to figure out long range. Are those trends that General Motors is taking, is that going to be work for dealers in our size or not? That's, we'll just have to see.
So I've been so excited about today. In my book, it's called Tom Hawkins Day. Tom is one of my favorite people in this industry. We've met, how many years ago was it, Tom?
Oh, probably 7 or 8 years ago in Charlotte.
That's right. That's right. And just hit it off from there. Tom Hawkins is the dealer principal of Hawkins Chevrolet in Fairmont, Minnesota. So thank you for coming today. You know, I just want to kind of kick it off and start off. If you could tell our audience just a little history about yourself. I know you have a long history, a family history of being in the automotive industry.
I'm actually technically a third generation. You could call it that. My mom grew up in the car business. Her dad started in the car business in the 40s. And her family business in a little town of Jackson, Minnesota was the first dealership, General Motors dealership in Minnesota, and one about the fourth in the nation to have all five GM lines. That was back when every division was separate. So in the mid 60s. I grew up in the business. My dad and mom got in the business in the late 60s. So I grew up in it from about fourth grade on. I never planned on getting in the business, but after college, I graduated from college in 1981 and was searching for a job. And about that time, my dad had and mom asked if I'd come home and help them in the business. You're too young to remember, but 1981 interest rates were actually 15% to 18%. Whether you bought a car or a house, they were really high interest rates. Ronald Reagan had just taken over for Jimmy Carter after the presidential election. There was a lot of inflation going on. And the farm economy in our area was tanking. And so they asked if I'd just come home and help and bring some young blood. So April 6th, I'll be celebrating 40 years in the car business. So I started on April 6th of 1981. And so I've had one job my whole life. I really had no intention to be in the business, but they asked. And so I came home. We were in a town of 1,500 at that time. So when I first came home, business was tough and people thought we were going out of business because of the times. And so we had no traffic. So I actually started going out door to door. I went actually farm to farm. I went out in the country south of Sherburn and started knocking on doors, introducing myself. And I actually sold my first car going door to door. About the third day out, somebody said, well, yeah, I'm actually interested in the car. And so I ended up selling them a 1981 Impala. And, my very first car was a brand new Chevy Impala. So that was kind of fun. We spent about 8 years there in Sherburn, and I had an uncle who's a very successful dealer. He actually ran my grandfather's dealership, and about 3 years after he got my dad in Sherburn, he moved on to a larger town in Wisconsin because General Motors thought he should be in a big town. Well, so about 8 years after I moved home, he thought, you know, a town of 1,500 isn't going to be good for car dealerships long-term. And there was a dealership nearby in the town I'm in now that was available and said, why don't you, and I told him somebody approached us about buying it. Well, he said, well, go see how much they want. I said, Lee, you know, we don't have any money. You know, we're just a low, we're an undercapitalized little dealer in a town of 1500. He said, tell him your uncle will buy in with you. So he actually bought in and helped us, my dad and I, buy this dealership that we're at now. And we've been here ever since. It'll be 30. It was just 32 years the first of the year that we were here. Wow. in Fairmont. So anyway, we've enjoyed being here. I have a younger brother who's now running the company, and Fairmont is a rural farm market. We're southern Minnesota compared to big cities, very conservative, very Republican area. But it's all been an ag economy. And so we kind of ride on the ag economy. When the national economy is doing well, the farm economy is typically not doing well with low crop prices. And so we're just now coming out of a low crop price time the last 6 or 7, 8 years. in our business has been a struggle because the farm economy has been struggling, but it's now finally turning around. So anyway, it's I've enjoyed being in the rural dealership. And like I say, I've had one job my whole life, different than most people I meet in this business.
Well, so, I know you have, is it three or four boys?
I have three boys, and none of them are interested in the car business. Two of them might be capable. One of them definitely is not. He's in the trades, and he's a plumber, and he needs to stay in that business. But they're just not interested. They saw the time that I put into the business, and it kind of turned them off to the business because I, like a lot of people, put too much time in as my family was growing, and we're in a small town anyway, and the other two wanted to be in the bigger town. They're both in the Minneapolis area living, so and that's okay. And like I say, I have a younger brother who's a partner, 6 years younger, and then I have another younger brother, 12 years younger, who's not a partner, but he is now the general manager, and he probably has the Marquardt. My uncle was Lee Marquardt in Wisconsin. He has the most Marquardt tendency, so he's doing a good job of getting us turned around and operating well. And so I'm doing the things that I'm doing are things that I like to do. The marketing and the inventory and the technology stuff are, instead of working on the business, he's doing that, things I should have done for years, and he's doing a good job. So like I say, we're a rural car dealership. We different than a lot of the metro car dealers. We're tendency to be used car focused. We've always kind of been 2-to-1 used to new ratio. We're in metro markets. You got, a lot more percentage of new car sales, but so we've always been in a, used car focus, for my whole career, basically.
Okay. Well, so knowledge is power. Like we just mentioned at the beginning of this interview, we met about 8 years ago at a conference. Right. You've always been very involved in social media and different groups and listening to webinars and, reading everything AutoSuccess that you can. Can you give some tips or pointers to our audience on, just maybe some easy, quick ways that they could reach out and, educate themselves on what's going on in the market right now, how to better their dealership?
Well, like you're right, knowledge is power. And I'm just one of those people who felt like, I always could learn more. And so I took advantage of everything that I found. And that's kind of how I met a lot of the people in this business. I listened to a lot of the AutoSuccess podcast way back when it was new. I listened to a lot of other webinars. I'd get on any webinar that was free. How I ended up in that mastermind group where I met you was because it was free to the dealer, being a small dealer, it was always an expense to go to a conference or go to some of those events. So anytime I had a chance to pick up knowledge for free, I did. And but most of the knowledge I got is, being 40 years in the car business. I mean, I just learned a lot. I'm not the most successful dealer compared to my colleagues, but I've learned a lot and I gained a lot of wisdom because of the time I spent into it. The other thing is my uncle, he was always real progressive. So when he's about, 3 hours away from here. And so when he would hire these trainers to come in, he'd invite me to come up to Eau Claire and sit in. So the guy, I don't know if you ever heard of a guy named Clint McGee. He had him up there, a guy named Jackie Cooper, a guy named Don Beveridge, who was more of a process guy. And then he had Tom Stuker in there for phone training. And in fact, I got my phone training in the late 80s, early 90s, from Grant Cardone, because Grant Cardone worked for Tom Stuker for a few years. And he actually trained me on the phone way back in the day. So that was really interesting. Also, when computers made the scene, I got an interest in technology and computers. So I became a computer nerd, self-taught, when, back in the Windows 95 days. And so I've always brought technology in as much as I could afford to, probably more than I could afford to, into the business where I could. So, I've just learned that, anything you can do to educate yourself by getting involved, I've just never been afraid to seek out information. I've never been felt like, I know more than I need, that I need to not learn anymore. I've always reached out to people and got help. Even at 62 years old, I'm still asking questions on Facebook groups and talking to people and asking. I just had a nice phone call with Tom LaPointe last night, who shared me some things that from his standpoint, I'm always learning, and I'm thankful for that. And
So make your own tribe is what you're saying.
Exactly. Create your own tribe. I count on the people like yourself and others that have contacts of ways I can learn. So I've really appreciated that. And that's how I got to be interested in a guy like Mark Tour, who did a lot of he was on your podcast. He was one of my favorite podcast people that you had on there. He had a lot of common sense came out of him. So I enjoyed, I haven't done that lately, but I did a long time. That was one of the things I did every day listen to that. So, but there's a lot of good things out there, and I hope people continue to take advantage and never feel like they never have something to learn, because I'll be learning till I die. I know that. So
there's a new platform out there called Clubhouse. And I know that I've seen you in on some of the sessions that I've been in. So do you feel like that's maybe a good way, something new to try that a lot of people aren't trying yet?
Yeah, I'm a fan of Clubhouse. It's really more of a national platform. I'm trying to think of, is there a way to make it relevant for a car dealer in a small market? I don't think it's there yet, at least not especially in my area. I don't know anybody locally. I've gotten two local people who I've invited on, but I've never seen them on there. But otherwise, it's pretty much all the people through the auto business. And I've also met other people since I've been in there. I've connected with a guy named Dennis Yu, who is actually a search analyst at Yahoo way back in the beginning. He's got his own business now, and I've connected with him and done some things. And then a PR person from New York area, gotten in on, she has some, a conservative political group on there. And so I've got involved in that a little bit. But otherwise, what I've learned about Clubhouse is I'll go in sometimes in some of the bigger groups with a lot of people I know, like Frank Lopes and John Dawson and everybody else who's got a room going, Michelle McLean, and I'll listen in some of the big rooms. I don't have plan on getting up there. And then there's other times that I'll get on where it's just a small group of people. Arnold T. Arena hosts a room every night. That's more of a social thing. They talk car business, but it's other things too. And I like those because you can get in a small group. You can get on stage. You can ask questions. And I've enjoyed that. In fact, the place where I met you, the Unfair Automotive Mastermind Group, we now have a day or a weekly podcast on Thursday mornings. Mm-hmm. And I actually got on stage today and asked a question because they had somebody, a specialist on subprime finance. So I asked a question there, but usually I just listen there. So I use it for both ways. And I like when I want to just listen, I'm doing something else in the background, but I want to hear what's going on. I'll get in the bigger group. If I get in the small group, I get called up on stage. So I try to do that when I know I want to contribute or learn from somebody there. So I think it's a great tool, and I hope more people get involved in it. And when they get the Android phones, which I know very few people use Android phones, but that's soon going to be available on Android as well. And I just, it's really different hearing people's voices and having engagement. I think it's really if no one's checked it out yet, I have about 8 invites right now. I'd be glad to give away. But everybody's got invites now. It's pretty easy to get on the platform. So no, it's a great platform, and I will see. There's a lot of people who are using it well and sharing. It's mostly sharing their knowledge, sharing the things, helping other people. That's kind of been the venue that I've seen the most. So it's a good platform. Perfect.
Well, I have some invites too if anybody needs them. I also wrote an article on my LinkedIn, just kind of recapping what it's all about and maybe some helpful hints on how to participate. So. Yeah, cool. Okay, so 2020 was a weird year. How is your 2021 over your 2020? And what did you apply in 2020 that you've kept for 2021?
Well, 2020 was a strange year because it's actually our first growth year in a few years. But you know, from talking to other people, it sounds like that it was really a record year for a lot of car dealerships around the nation. COVID was good to car dealers. And that sounds a little bit caustic to say, but basically COVID disrupted the market enough that our margins improved a lot because you could buy cars when people were uncertain. And then when the car companies shut down new car production for a while, that created some shortages that made the demand side stronger than the supply side. And it's still that way. So even though it's hard to buy cars right now, if we're getting them on trade, the margins are better. And of course, our holding costs are low because we have no inventory. And so we're making money on the financing side or the floor plan side of the new car business. So So we're thankful for that. We in Minnesota here, we were lucky enough. We were considered essential for service and appointment only for sales. And of course, anybody who walked on the lot, we considered an appointment, of course. So it was other than, you know, doing good, cleaning and sanitation and wearing masks, we operated pretty much as business as usual. We didn't have a whole lot of people who bought cars and wanted them delivered. We did a lot of pickups and deliveries for service, but we didn't do much of that other than like we would normally to somebody several hours away or a few states away. So most people were willing to come and follow. We followed the guidelines and they followed the guidelines. But it's just, I think the market is such that it was in flux enough that our margins are better. And even with the low inventory, so it was a good year. And I thought it'd probably slow down in January, but so far it hasn't.
Right.
And part of that's attributed to some marketing that we took on for the first time. I think that has something to do with it. So we're thankful that 20 was a good year, and 21 is starting out so far, at least the first 2 months, just like it was. I would say the last 8 months of 20, the first couple of months were a little tight. Then, of course, March and April took a big drop. But then in the 8 months following, we recovered everything that we lost in March and April, plus gained a lot more. So we had a profitable year. We think it's going to stay good as long as we can keep getting inventory and get more inventory in. Again, new cars have been really tough with the semiconductor shortage and part shortages. I was just telling a customer a little bit ago, we could get the car companies could build all the new cars they want if they could get components. There's part shortages all over caused by COVID that are really limiting production. So we'll see how it goes. Hopefully in the next few months, that'll start improving and things will smooth out.
What are you doing to overcome the inventory issue right now?
Well, we're just doing what we're working harder on, because we were never very good at acquiring our inventory through the service drive like a lot of people do. We never felt we could afford using, data mining products, but we're doing that kind of on our own using our, there's some tools that we can use in our CRM to help kind of set up for that. So Nick, our sales manager, has been doing some of that with some success. He's been sending out some emails asking people about inventory. So the thing that seems to be working the best for us and why we think traffic is staying good is we've never done anything like Google AdWords. You know, we're a small dealership. You know, you have to pay somebody to do that if you want to do it right. And we just never felt we could afford that. And we wanted to try some Facebook advertising. And so we looked at a couple options and we went with actually a local Minnesota company that somebody referred me to that I knew. I didn't even think about them. But for the first time, we're doing dynamic Facebook ads and retargeting Facebook ads. And that's almost double the traffic on our website. And we think that has a lot to do with some of our traffic improvement. The other thing we did is we're small enough that we don't have a BDC. And General Motors is really pushing us to get a BDC. And so after trying to hire somebody who could maybe be a one-person BDC to handle both sales and some service marketing, we couldn't find anybody. So we hired a virtual BDC company just recently, and that seems to be working out real good. We're actually short one salesperson. Our third salesperson is retirement age. His family wanted him to take some time off at COVID. And so he comes back basically for appointment only. When somebody comes in, they want to deal with him. They don't want to switch to somebody else. They call him up and he'll come in and he sells 3-4 cars a month. But he's kind of half retired. He likes it. It's working for us. With the two salespeople, having somebody handling all the incoming leads on a virtual basis to the appointment setup, that's working well so far in this 45 days we've been doing it. And hopefully so those two things, the Facebook marketing, and actually we're only spending about $1,000 a month of actual Facebook ad spend, but the company's telling us, listen, you're getting as much as you can get. We don't think we could spend any more money and have any more benefits. So
wow, that's a good company to tell you that.
Yeah, no, and that's right. So it doesn't sound like we're getting a lot of competition for that down here is probably the reason. That could change in the future. But so we're thankful for that. And so those two things have really helped us, keep in spite of the stuff we're having, we're turning stuff over a little faster. And the stuff that does age on us, we're not losing big money out of this. We're finding buyers for it. I think that's just a product of the market shortage. So
awesome. Okay, I'm just going to ask one final question. What trends are you looking forward to in the near future?
The one thing, the trend that I'm seeing that I like, which is more of a local thing, is that the farm economy seems to be improving finally. You know, the farm prices are up. And of course, in if you ever dealt with the ag economy, farmers like to spend money when they have it, you know, and they're conservative and they don't overspend. But when they when things are good, they buy cars, they buy farm equipment, they buy trucks. And so so I'm thankful that that trend is changing. From the long term trend, the car business, I don't have anything that I'm super excited about because we're, you know, maybe digital retailing, but we're small enough that digital retailing won't be a force for us until it maybe gets more cost effective. And but the ones I'm, you know, I'm unsure about or concerned about is what's a long-term thing from General Motors. General Motors has made an announcement now that they're going to be all EV by 2035. What does that mean for dealers in small rural markets like ours? In the Midwest, there's a lot of towns our size. There's a lot of Chevy dealers per square mile in the Midwest and anywhere else because of the farm economy. The farm economy has always been fairly stable. And so the smaller dealerships that went away all over the country didn't go away as much around the Midwest. So we have more dealerships around here. What does that mean when, you know, we're not an EV dealer right now? We dropped it because of a $30,000 investment to sell the Chevy Bolt. Well, if they're going to be all EV by 2035, what does that mean? Do I need to get into it? Do I need to upgrade my facility? Do I need to also, is it going to be viable for an EV dealer in the rural market? Those are things I have to figure out. I mean, I think it might be. I'm not pessimistic about it. I'm just unsure about it. I just have to find a way to figure out long range. Are those trends that General Motors is taking, is that going to be work for dealers in our size or not? That's, we'll just have to see. You know, a friend of mine said that a small Chevy dealer bought a used Bolt one time just to try it out and to see what the vehicle was like. And he got scared by the fact that the Chevy Bolt didn't need any maintenance for 150,000 miles. So he's thinking, what is our service department going to look like when we're all EV? You know, these are things that we don't know. And so those are the trends that I wouldn't say I'm excited about that. I'm just watching. And I'm not pessimistic, but I say, what's going to happen for dealers our size in the future? And we'll see what happens. The good thing is at 62 years old, I'm starting thinking about what do I want to do after this business, or starting to ease out, partly ease out and enjoy life too. So that all plays into it. And, you know, and we're, you know, who's going to run the business the next time if it survives for long term, you know, once EVs come. And frankly, we're not sure. I mean, I've told people I don't think we're going to be all EV by 2035, like GM says. I just don't think the market is where GM thinks it's going to be by then, but I could be wrong. You know, that's right.
Well, I know if anybody's going to find out all of the information and all of the knowledge behind it, it's going to be you.
Oh, thank you. I try to stay informed. And that's one thing I learned by getting on Clubhouse, staying connected with the people like yourself that I've met in the industry. You know, I'm known by a lot of people, not well, but I just know a lot of people there's a lot of people I can reach out to and talk to who are much more knowledgeable. And I'm thankful for the networking and that I've done and the people that I've met through going to these conferences over the last several years, just to, you know, I can call somebody up and say, what do you think about this? Or where should I go on this? And I'm very thankful for that, you know, I've made those connections over the years. And cause you know, even though I've been in the business 40 years, there's a lot of stuff I don't know. And there's a lot of stuff people younger than me that know more, and I'm willing to learn from them. So.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, thank you for taking the time to chat with me today. As always, it's awesome.
I'm anxious to run into you somewhere again and see your husband again too. And I'm happy for you guys and your growing family. So good luck to you. And thanks for taking the time.
Thank you, Tom.
All right.